Good evening, everyone. How's everybody doing? I have the honor of introducing tonight's keynote speaker, Liz Wheeler. Liz Wheeler is unapologetically one of the conservative movement's boldest voices. In Politico's words, Liz is a titan of media, and she's just getting started. Liz became a household name in 2015 when she debuted as the host of the highly rated Tipping Point with Liz Wheeler program. Liz is passionate about telling the truth, rigorous in her research, and committed to her faith. Her drive to relentlessly defend against the radical left's takeover of our culture is born of a desire to see properly ordered society thrive in America once again, a society that values God over government, freedom over convenience, and individual liberty over victimhood and identity politics. Last year, she debuted her new video podcast, The Liz Wheeler Show, a favorite of many YAF activists. After being blocked by AOC, demonetized on Facebook, and whispered about in the Snopes water cooler, Liz Wheeler is undeterred, maybe even energized to continue the fight against the left. Please join me in welcoming Liz Wheeler.
For that, welcome. I appreciate that. First of all, thank you to the Young Americas Foundation for this incredible conference. I have actually been here all week behind the scenes filming my show, filming interviews, and I've been able to peek in here a few times to see what you guys are doing, see the other speakers, and the energy has been electric, and it's such an honor to be your closing speaker tonight. So thank you. Thank you so much for having me. A special thanks to, I know I've seen a lot of students. I've seen you guys in the hallways. I've seen you guys getting off and on elevators. Tonight, I did see earlier a middle-aged governor masquerading as a student. Where is he tonight? Governor Walker, thank you, sir, for having me here today. Thank you to Pat Coyle. Thank you to all the donors whose generosity makes tonight possible. We greatly appreciate you. And yes, round of applause. And thank you to all of you guys, the students attending this conference, who took a week out of your summer to come here out of your love for our nation to learn about conservative values and become equipped to be the next generations of leaders in our country. It's really an incredible thing to see, and I'm grateful for you. I'm also grateful for everybody who wasn't able to get away and come here in person. Everybody watching online, welcome. We're glad you're here as well. And I don't know, I'm just speechless. Look at this place. The stage is gorgeous. All the gentlemen, you look dashing. The ladies, you look lovely. What an honor it is for me to be here tonight. I actually feel like I know half your names already because I've seen so many of you on college campuses throughout the last year or two. I mean, I saw Rhett here earlier. I saw Matt, he's sitting right up here. I saw Charlotte and Vivian and so many others. And I hope to see many more of you in this upcoming year because boy, do we have a lot to talk about. Now, I want to do things just a little bit differently tonight. I am not here tonight to talk at you. I am not here to present a lecture to you tonight. I am here specifically to deputize you tonight. I want each and every one of you at every single table in this room to go back to your college campuses next month, and I want you to force your schools to abolish their DEI programs. I want you to get rid of the diversity, equity, and inclusion offices at every single school that's represented in this room. DEI initiatives, it stands for diversity, equity, and inclusion, is not good. It is not moral. It is not just. It's not something that on campus or in the corporate world or in our country that we should strive to achieve. If we are playing by the rules of the radical left, then you and I must reject DEI. Because diversity, as told to us, as defined by the left, is not the diversity that we would think of. It's not diversity of thought. It's not diversity of experience. It's not diversity of viewpoint. And equity, likewise, is not equality. It's certainly not equality under the law, and it's not equal opportunity. Inclusion is not tolerance, tolerating different viewpoints, different religious beliefs, or lifestyle choices. No. If we are playing by the rules of the left, as they define these terms and this initiative, the DEI initiatives, then diversity is racism. Equity is both discrimination and authoritarianism. And inclusion is religious persecution. Now, I bet if I ask you tonight for a show of hands, if I ask how many of you have DEI offices at your school right now, almost every single one of you, except, by the way, the students at Hillsdale, almost every single one of you would raise your hand. I actually recently read a statistic that the vast majority of college campuses not only have DEI initiatives, but they actually have executive-level administrators whose formal responsibility in their job is to promote DEI on campus. In fact, get this, the average university has 45 administration members who have formal responsibility in their jobs for promoting DEI goals. In case you're wondering about the context of that number, that means that the average university has almost 1.4 times to be specific, as many DEI personnel as tenured or tenured track history professors. I think that shows us where their priorities lie. So before I get ahead of myself today, we need to actually define a term. The definition of words is incredibly important in our nation and increasingly under assault. So let's start today by asking the question, what is DEI? The words diversity, equity, and inclusion sound pretty neutral. They're fairly vanilla words. They have a generally positive connotation in the context of history, in the context of the English language. So why exactly is DEI, as defined by the left, why is this bad? Well, the left changes the definition of words for two very specific reasons, and we're going to come back to that in a moment because it's very important that we recognize why. But first, let's deconstruct these words as they pertain to these initiatives, particularly on your college campuses. Let's start with diversity. Now, it can sound controversial that I say diversity is racism. And my intention is not to be sensationalist. My intention is not to be bombastic. My intention is to accurately describe the actions the radical left is taking under the guise of these terms. So let me give you an example here. After Ketanji Brown Jackson was nominated to the Supreme Court of the United States by President Biden, and then after she was sworn into office, ABC's Good Morning America sent out the following tweet. This is what they said. Ketanji Brown Jackson is sworn in as the first Black Supreme Court justice in US history. Now, is that true?
No.
It is not true because Clarence Thomas, the last time I checked, I'm not a biologist, but the last time I checked, he is a Black man. But to the left, Clarence Thomas isn't the right kind of Black man. Because the left thinks that you should be forced to adhere to certain ideology based on the color of your skin. My friends, that is racism. And that is how the left defines diversity. There's actually a funny, not funny story that happened in Vermont recently. There was a city council committee that was, the intention of this committee was to foster equity and inclusion. And they decided that they needed a Black man on this committee because its goal was diversity, equity, and inclusion. So they hired a man by the name of Keith Longmore to serve in this position. And Keith Longmore, again, a Black man, came into this committee, and almost immediately after, he told his fellow committee members, he told them that this committee was a fraud. He told them that this committee was an affront to the families of this city. And what did this committee do? They voted him off the board. They voted the Black man off the diversity board because he didn't adhere to their radical leftist ideology. That, my friends, is also racism. Diversity of thought and diversity of experience are what we're used to when we define this term. But when the left defines this term, they do not define it the same way. It's not just diversity based on immutable characteristics, which is an insult, and we'll get to that in a moment as well. It's actually worse, because the left defines diversity not just by immutable characteristics, but whether that person with the desired immutable characteristic adheres to the leftist ideology that they have assigned to that person based on the immutable characteristic. So it's not just racism, it's actually racism times two. To assign somebody beliefs and opinions based on skin color is insulting, it's demeaning. Treating someone as not the right kind of black person is outright racist. So if we are playing by the rules of the left, then diversity in the diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives is racism. Then of course we have equity. What is equity? Equity, as presented by the left, they act like this is equality. They act as if you do not support equity, that you are not supporting equality under the law. But that is not what equity actually is. So during COVID, when there was monoclonal antibodies that were being used as a treatment for severe cases, when this treatment first came to market here in the United States, there was a limited supply of this. And so it was being prioritized for people who had serious comorbidities or other factors, usually age, sometimes weight-related health factors that would make them more likely to have a serious case of COVID or a COVID fatality. But a healthcare organization in the Midwest by the name of SSM Health actually used skin color as part of their determining algorithm for who would be eligible to receive monoclonal antibodies. So they had a risk scoring calculator, and in order to be eligible for this treatment, possibly a life-saving treatment, you had to score a minimum of 20 points on this risk calculator. The color of a person's skin was worth more points than any health-related comorbidity. In fact, the risk scoring calculator provided a 7-point bonus to all patients who were either non-white or Hispanic. The color of your skin is not a health condition. It's not a comorbidity. It's not an indicator of whether COVID is going to be a serious illness for you or not. This is discrimination. It's rationing of medical care based on the color of somebody's skin. What is that? If we define what I just said, what is that? That is racial discrimination done under the name of health equity. That's not only wrong, that's evil. Ketanji Brown Jackson is actually another good example of equity. President Biden announced that he would nominate to the Supreme Court someone who was a woman and who was black. Those were the first two qualifying factors that he announced. And as a woman, when he said this, I thought, what could possibly be more insulting to women? To elevate them to positions of power based on our DNA and our bodies? What about our minds and our ideas and our qualifications and our skills? None of that. This President Biden has turned the time back on the advancement of women in our nation more than any president in recent history. In the name of equity? Equity is discrimination. Equity is not equality. Equity is equal outcome. Equal outcome is very different than equal opportunity. It's very different than equality under the law. Equal outcome requires that someone is held back by someone else in authority. It's not a marketplace where the person that's maybe the fastest runner, or the person that's the best debater, or the person that's the most skilled at whatever skill they have is chosen as the winner or hired for the job. Equal outcome requires that some arbiter of truth choose who wins and chooses who loses, based on an immutable characteristic. The last time I checked, that's literally against the law in our country. That is discrimination. Equity is racial discrimination, and it breeds, by the way, it breeds tokenism. As I mentioned, it's insulting for women to be elevated. This is true not just for women. This is true for any minority that's artificially elevated based on immutable characteristics. It's incredibly harmful for women in positions of power to wonder, did I get here because I deserve to be here? Based on the hard work that I've done in my life and my career, am I here because I'm a token? And what's even worse than thinking about that yourself is knowing that your coworkers are wondering the same thing. This is what the left has brought to us in the name of equity. What's even worse, actually, is equity breeds authoritarianism, because in order to have that equal outcome, there has to be someone who's choosing to discriminate. So who does the choosing on who to discriminate? Who to discriminate against? Who are these arbiters of equity or equal outcome? Well, the answer to that is pretty obvious. The arbiters are the radical left who has given us these DEI initiatives. They single-handedly determine what you're allowed to have or not have, what you're allowed to achieve or not achieve, And that, my friends, is just dictatorship. That's basically another word for socialism. Socialism, we know how socialism turns out. Everyone is equally miserable. And that's equity as defined by the radical left. So then we get to inclusion. Inclusion, when we think about inclusion, what do we think of? I think of tolerance for someone else's religious beliefs. I'm Christian, maybe tolerance for an atheist to live their life how they so choose. I'm a practicing Catholic, I believe in that marriage is between one man and one woman, but tolerance is respecting someone else's right to pick whatever partner they want as long as it's a consenting adult. That's tolerance. Advocating for equality under the law without embracing or celebrating necessarily someone else's life choice. But that's not the definition of inclusion that the radical left is trying to force down our throats. The best examples of what inclusion actually means to the radical left is the transgender athletes who are allowed, even if they're biological males, they're allowed to use women's bathrooms. Think about those college students, just your peers, who are forced to change in front of a biological male in the name of inclusion. That's maybe the easiest example. Jack Phillips from Masterpiece Cake Shop, I'm sure you're familiar with that story. He declined to use his free expression to create a custom wedding cake for a gay wedding because gay marriage violated his religious belief that marriage is between one man and one woman. And he's been culturally and legally decapitated for this. The left has tried to force him out of business, out of the public sphere. This is inclusion as defined by the radical left, but it's a step worse. If you go up to Canada, it's not just called DEI. It's not just called diversity, equity, and inclusion. They've added another letter to it. They've added a B to it. That B stands for belonging. And belonging takes this idea of inclusion, which is already verging on religious persecution, and it takes it to a whole other level. Because what they mean when they say we want you to belong is they mean we want you to feel quote unquote safe being your quote unquote authentic selves. In and of itself, again, those words are vanilla, neutral, maybe even have a positive connotation. But think about this. Is it possible to marry the concept when talking about race, for example, with the far left narrative that tells us that all white people are inherently racist, not based on each white person's particular thoughts or treatment or feelings of people from another race, but just because that white person is enjoying the white privilege built on and generations, their own ancestors, of what the left terms white supremacy. Meaning, it doesn't matter how you act and how you treat other people, you will be deemed racist just based on the color of your skin. Is it possible to marry that concept, which the radical left lays before us, with equality? With actual inclusion. The left then tells black people that they're fundamentally unsafe around racism, which again, neutrally sounds accurate, but the left defines racism as their previous premise, that every white person is inherently racist. So then you get to a point where the left tells black people that they are unsafe around all white people. And what does this lead to? This leads to segregation. This leads to black-only spaces, or BIPOC-only doors, dorms, lunches, and picnics for people of color only. That's not tolerance. That's not inclusion. That's segregation, discrimination, and religious persecution. There was actually the Conference on College Composition and Communication, which is an affiliate of the National Council of Teachers of English, so your English professor is probably part of this. They released a demand for college professors to stop teaching black students standard English grammar and stop downgrading black students in their college papers if they used improper grammar. Why? Because this board suggested that this is demeaning to black students and lowers their self-esteem. When a teacher at the University of California at Los Angeles actually did this, when he correctly downgraded a student for using improper English in an academic paper, a student group called Call to Action, Graduate Students of Color, claimed that correcting a black student constitutes a microaggression, and they launched a sit-in of the professor's next lecture. Does this sound like inclusion to you? It does not, because inclusion is not tolerance. Inclusion is not equality under the law. Inclusion is the premise that you will be made to care. You will be forced not only to accept, something that you don't believe, but to violate the very core of your conscience, your relationship with Christ, your religious values, because the left said you had to. Inclusion means if you dissent, you will be placed in an ideological straitjacket. Inclusion is persecution against people of faith who practice their faith. It's punishment if you don't celebrate radical leftist ideology. So that, my friends, is the short answer to what is DEI? That is DEI. Diversity is racism. Equity is discrimination and authoritarianism. Inclusion is religious persecution if we're playing by the definition of the left. These things, and I hardly need to state this, are very bad things. Telling black people that they have to think a certain way and vote for a particular political party because of the color of their skin is racism. Refusing to consider a white woman for a job because of the color of her skin is racial discrimination. Refusing to consider an Asian man for a job because of the color of his skin and his sex is both racial discrimination and sexual discrimination. Denying medical treatment to someone based on the color of their skin is also racism. It's discrimination, and it's particularly evil. Culturally decapitating a man in his business because he is a professing Christian and declines to offend God with his free expression, that's religious persecution at the hands of the state, and it's wrong. All of these things are part of the left's definition of diversity, equity, and inclusion. So let's talk about this phrase that I've said multiple times. If we are playing by the rules of the left, if we accept the premise, the left's definition of diversity, equity, and inclusion. This is a trick that the left employs with increasing frequency. I don't know if you guys notice, but the recession that we are now in apparently identifies as trans prosperity. Because we are no longer allowed to identify our economic identity because it's been groomed into thinking that it's something that it's not by the Democrats. I don't know if this sounds familiar, but it's because it's a favorite tactic of the left right now. The left changes definitions of words on a regular basis, and they do this for two reasons. They first take a word that has a definition that has either existed for almost all of civilization, like marriage between one man and one woman, or we'll get to some other examples. They take this word and they tell you, your understanding of this word is not only wrong, it's hateful, and it's evil. And then they twist the definition to first fit their own political agenda. The recession example just, you know, is an example in and of itself. Thank you for that. This week, Joe Biden. And they do this on a frequent basis. They do this with defining abortion as healthcare when it's clearly the antithesis of healthcare. They do this when they try to redefine the word woman or the word man or the word gender to suit their political narrative. They do this actually when they try to define our speech as violence and the left's violence as free speech. This is a tactic that they have latched onto. Because it doesn't only serve their political agenda in the short term, it serves their political agenda in the long term. And what I mean by this is it allows the left to become the arbiter of truth. If we have a word that you and I understand the definition, because this definition has existed in the English language and long before our country was even founded, and they tell us that that's no longer the definition, then what is it as humans we respond with? We say, well, what is the actual definition? And that is exactly what the left wants us to do. Because the left then wants to supply us with their definition. And when they do this, this allows them to be authoritarian. They can redefine any word to mean anything. And if they can redefine any word to mean anything, then we are not a nation of laws. We are a nation of the Democrats' whims. We are a nation of whatever radical leftist agenda item is highest on their priority list, and they will use this manipulation and then punishment if you don't adhere to DEI, if you don't accept our new definition of this word that you previously understood to mean something different, they will socially and sometimes legally punish you for dissent. It allows them not only to serve their immediate political agenda, it allows them to become authoritarian. And you can actually see this in action at your own schools. I'm sure that you have seen this on your campuses. If you think about how the structure of DEI initiatives work, it works essentially like a social credit score. It's like the Chinese social credit score. You've heard about what they do in China, right? Where if each citizen has a credit score issued to them, not a credit like credit card credit score, but a social score, and if a Chinese citizen misbehaves in the eyes of the Chinese Communist Party, then they're downgraded. If that Chinese citizen behaves as the Chinese Communist Party wants them to do, they're upgraded. So something as simple as smoking outdoors or not using the crosswalk can get you downgraded. If you praise the government publicly on social media, that gets you upgraded. If you criticize the Chinese Communist Party to a family member, you're downgraded. This is an absolute method of complete control over any people. And we see this happening in our world right now. This is not something new that's coming to the United States. And the punishment from the Chinese Communist Party can be anything from you're not allowed to buy property, to you're not allowed to fly in an airplane, to your children aren't allowed to go to a private school or go to any school, to you are sent to a re-education camp or you are simply disappeared. Your bank account disappears, your print as a soul on this earth, your footprint is completely wiped away. This is what DEI structure looks like. DEI structure is structured like a social credit score, where if you don't virtue signal with radical leftist ideology, you will be shamed, you will be punished, you will be coerced, and possibly even canceled. And the only way to redeem yourself from this is through re-education, through thought control, as defined by the left, which is essentially thought reform. The goal of DEI is not actual diversity, equality, or inclusion. The goal of DEI is absolute power over our lives, control of us. The goal of DEI is to help usher Marxism into our country. And I know Marxism, that word is oftentimes used as an empty pejorative against our political opponents, but I want to give you a concrete example of what I mean so that you know that I'm not using this word in an empty way. Critical race theory. We've heard about this a lot in the past 2 years. Critical race theory is the grandchild of critical theory. Critical theory is a Marxist school of thought that was developed or created by Marxists at the Frankfurt School in the 1960s. Critical race theory applies that critical theory framework to issues of race in our nation. And the strategy or the tool, the reason why the left is using critical race theory is because they want to destroy our civil institutions. What do I mean by civil institutions? I mean institutions that are not governmental. I mean the nuclear family. I mean marriage between one man and one woman. I mean the relationship between parents and their children. The fact that parents have dominion over their own kids and the decisions that are made about their children, including the curriculum that their children are taught in school. This Marxist tactic, this Marxist plot is to topple the civil institutions on which our governmental institutions rely. Because we can't have a nation, a government, that has limited enumerated powers if we don't have institutions on which people rely, like the family and like church. We aren't set up to be a successful big daddy welfare state. And if you destroy the nuclear family, that's exactly what you would create. You would create a whole population of people who no longer rely on the family. They depend on the government. This is the Marxist tactic that is behind critical race theory. And critical race theory is being infused into our society, not just in your history classes, not just in K-12 schools. It's being infused into our society via DEI initiatives. DEI initiatives that exist at almost every one of your universities, at almost every workplace where you will apply after you graduate from college. And it's hard to escape. My friends, it's time to end that. When Marxists force us to redefine words, it forces us to acknowledge them as the arbiters of truth. And if we don't understand who exactly we're fighting and the ideology that they espouse, we will not fight well. So I challenge you tonight, I charge you tonight to fully understand who it is that we are fighting. That we are not fighting simply dumb politicians with unwise policies that don't work when they're applied, and you'd think the dumb left would be, you know, have some brains to realize that. No. We are fighting against an evil ideology. And sure, there are dumb politicians who are useful idiots to this ideology, but that's not the crux of the matter. The crux of the matter is if we don't understand what we're fighting, we won't fight well. But you can fight well. You can fight DEI at your schools. by oversight of DEI offices and officers. You can watch them. You can report on them. You can report on their practices, on their pamphlets, on their training materials, on their trainings, on their social media accounts. You can report on everything that they are doing. You can educate your fellow students on the left or on the right, because when you accurately articulate what DEI is, what the left defines as diversity, equity, and inclusion, it is an abhorrent ideology to the vast majority of people. People who might have been gullible enough to fall for the left's redefinition, but who at their heart are not evil Marxists. You can expose the abuses of DEI that you see on your campus. I know Kara told you earlier tonight about YAF's campus bias tip line, but it's an incredibly powerful tool, and it has shown already that it works. I'd like to encourage you to use this liberally on your campuses this year. Send your tips to their campus bias tip line. It is yaf.org/tips. Because if we are playing by the rules of the left, if we are meeting them on their field of battle, then DEI on your college campuses and in corporations and workplaces across the country needs to die. You've spent your entire week, 1 week of your summer, hearing speakers talk to you about almost every topic under the sun. You've heard talk about liberty, you've heard talks about beauty, you've heard talks about institutions on which we rely, you've heard talks about media narratives that are false on every topic under the sun that can well equip you to be a fighter on your college campus. I'm speaking at the closing banquet tonight because what I'm speaking to you about is the culmination of everything that you have learned, everything that you have embraced over the past week. And I'm here to tell you that this is a fight that you can fight, that you are actually the best equipped fighters of anybody, of politicians, of parents, of activists. You are best equipped to fight this fight against DEI on your college campus. You now have the ammunition to win this fight. Consider yourself. Consider yourselves, every single one of you sitting here tonight, consider yourselves deputized. Now take what you've learned, light that fire in your belly, and go do it. Thank you very much. I'd be happy to take some of your questions now, but to the rest of you, if you're not lining up, pull out your cell phones for me, bring up iTunes or Spotify, click subscribe to The Liz Wheeler Show, and give me a 5-star rating. The left recently has been blowing us up with 1-star reviews, so, you know, try to help counter that effort. I'd be happy to take your questions, sir.
Okay, guys, when you come up, make sure to state your name, your school, and a brief question.
Hi, Mrs. Wheeler. My name's Charles from the University of Michigan. Good to see you again.
Hi, Charles. I remember you.
That's been happening all week, by the way.
It's just preparing you for the fight.
Very true, very true. So I wanted to ask you about the National Conservatism Statement of Principles that you signed, I think it was a couple weeks ago, maybe a month ago. I was wondering how compatible you thought the principles in the statement were with those of the conservatism of people like Ronald Reagan and William F. Buckley.
Great question. That's a really good question. And kudos for you for reading that entire statement of principles. I think it's very compatible, especially considering that the Republican Party in general, especially as it pertains to foreign policy, has gotten pretty completely off track in the last 20 years. Our party has been co-opted in large part by neocons who want to start wars and don't want to equip our fighting men and women to end those wars. And that's very different, by the way. You're often faced with this false choice that if you don't want this interventionism that we've seen, that you must be an isolationist. And clearly being an isolationist is also not practical in our day and age. And I think that that's a false choice. I think that there's, you could call it a happy medium. You could also call it a third point on a triangle, where foreign policy decisions should be made through asking the question, is this in the best interest of the United States of America, or what are the strategic interests of getting involved in this fight, specifically the interest of the United States? Is this good for us, or is this none of our business? Does this not serve us well? And this is a version of the foreign policy that we've seen. We actually saw it under the Trump administration in large part. It's very similar to America First foreign policy, but it's also the same thing, essentially, that Ronald Reagan espoused, that it was peace through strength, that we were not going to pretend to be isolationists, and we were going to critically think about our involvement in any foreign conflict, and if it was something that mattered to the United States, whether it was the spread of communism and socialism or something else, something that was a more direct military threat, then yes, we would get involved, and if not, then we might help strategically, but not by sending our own military. So in that sense, in the national security foreign policy sense, I feel like it's almost a reorientation. We are reclaiming that foreign policy philosophy from the politicians who've gotten the Republican Party so off track in the last 20 years.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi, Liz. Thank you for your excellent breakdown of DEI. My name is Stephanie Samsel, and I study political science and journalism at Towson University. Now, I think it goes without saying that people who want to run for office need to possess a certain ego. And I think that that could also apply to people who work in the media industry, such as journalists. A lot of people complain that journalists nowadays are nothing more than social media influencers. So what advice do you have to young, aspiring journalists like me who want to remain committed to truth-telling as opposed to succumbing to the charms of fame and popularity in such a self-obsessed world?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I would say that the principles that you practice in your workplace are generally a carryover from the principles that you practice in your personal life. So the first protection or layer of protection for yourself against being seduced by what's essentially idols, idolizing yourself or your own vanity, is to make sure that your identity is centered first in Christ, that you are not living for yourself, but you're living for Christ. That's the first thing. The second thing is, remember, no matter how powerful your career is or how high you ascend, the most important thing aside from your faith is your family. And as young people, you know, you'll be getting married and starting families here soon, and there's going to be a choice that you're going to face in the first decade especially of your career, whether to prioritize, you know, your husband or your wife or your children, or whether to prioritize your career. And I want you, when you face that choice, to remember that you should always prioritize your family. And when you do that, it insulates you against the temptation to make everything about yourself. The other two things that I will say is surround yourself with like-minded community, and make sure you stay friends. If you're going to be a public figure, stay friends with people who were friends with you long before you were in the public eye, because they know and love you for who you really are and not what you do. And you know, turn off social media whenever you can. Don't read those mentions. Just put that phone down. That's what I would say.
Great. Thank you.
I'm Shanti Saleya from Bushnell University. I'm on a campus where there's a lot of principled Christians, but they're hesitant to share their biblically informed political beliefs because they're afraid it will compromise their ability to reach out to others and to share the gospel. How can I encourage my peers that being open with their politics and being politically principled does not compromise their ability to share the gospel?
Tell them to open their Bible. Tell them to look at how Jesus shared the gospel. Look at how his apostles shared the gospel. Look at how early Christians shared the gospel. Were they worried all of the time that they might be rejected? Some of them were, and Jesus scolded them for that. You will run into persecution for your religious beliefs. The gospel tells us that you will be hated in his name. So if you expect that and are prepared for that, it's more tolerable when you encounter it. And it's certainly not something that should prevent you from sharing your faith. In fact, it shows more than ever that what you are doing is a threat to the devil Because aren't those feelings of fear, of craving social validation? I mean, that's the sin of vanity, right? So sin is placed in us as a temptation by the devil. And if you act according to your fear or to how the devil would have you act, then you are choosing to live by his principles and not by Christ. I would encourage Christians, practice with your friends first how you're going to answer this. Stay calm, be educated, be loving, be compassionate. Listen first before you talk to the concerns of the other side, because oftentimes, particularly young people, have been seduced by what seem like compassionate narratives by the other side, when in fact they're either not compassionate and or are a complete lie. Do not be afraid. God will always be with you. That's what I would say.
Thank you.
Hi, Liz Wheeler. I now listen to your podcast every week.
Thank you.
Since
love to hear that.
I met you in February at this conference. And I actually have a question about one of your podcasts, antinatalism. I realize that is probably the biggest issue that I see in young women that I'm friends with, that I'm close with, that and the hookup culture. And I'm worried that they will realize that it is bad before it is too late. How can I help guide them in the correct direction?
It is astonishing, actually, how viral antinatalism has gone. For those of you who don't know what this is, you might have seen the viral photos of billboards. This happened particularly in the Pacific Northwest, where it's a billboard. It's a black background with big block letters in white that just says stophavingkids.org. And if you visit this website, then this website tells you that it's your moral responsibility not to have children, not to have a family, because of two reasons. Because your child might be harmed by this impending climate disaster. That's the first reason. And the second reason is because your child might contribute to furthering or exacerbating this climate disaster that, you know, they've been telling us that we're going to face any day now for the last 50 years, and yet we're not facing. So the first thing is to identify to them exactly what they are afraid of. Are you afraid that your child might experience this climate catastrophe? Or are you afraid they might contribute to it, and then meet them where they are? If they're afraid that their child might experience it, then you talk about the history of these predictions that have been made by the radical left. They told us that all kinds of things would happen. They told us polar bears would be extinct. They told us we'd see 50 million climate refugees. They told us that different countries would be underwater by the year 2000, and that all the glaciers would be melted time and time and time again. They issue these apocalyptic warnings, and it doesn't come true. So make sure that they understand that it's normal to feel a maternal fear and protection for your children even before they're born. But make sure that that fear is rooted in fact, meaning their fear is not rooted in fact. The second part of that is if they're afraid that their child will contribute to the climate crisis, then you should point them, and I cited this in my episode, so maybe you can just send them the episode, or at least the citation in there. There are actual climatologists, and I say that a little tongue-in-cheek. These are climate change criers who work in the science field who have actually admitted that narrative is untrue, that one single baby or our generation having babies, which I highly encourage you to do, by the way, when you're married, that our generation having babies won't actually contribute to the climate crisis, again, tongue-in-cheek, because it's ignoring the fact that between now and when that child would allegedly contribute to that climate crisis, the policies that the left is advocating for would almost completely offset the carbon footprint that the baby would allegedly have. And so it's actually a very interesting argument from these people who claim to be the biggest proponents of climate change. They're thoroughly debunking that, and it's a very sad thing that so many young women are falling for that. And I would highly encourage you, do not fall for the leftists' anti-natalist, anti-baby, anti-woman garbage.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Christian from the Catholic University of America.
I remember you. Hi.
Yes, I asked you about integralism at Faith and Freedom.
You did, and I've forgiven you for asking that.
So I wanted to just ask you again, especially in light of recently controversial issues like same-sex marriage and contraception, how much should we kind of impose our Catholic faith on policy and government, and how much should we leave those issues up to kind of us as individual Catholics and evangelizing to our fellow Catholics or fellow
So in other words,
Americans.
You're asking me about integralism again on national TV.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, so let me tell you guys a little story. When we went to, when I went to this event where he asked me about integralism, I was like, dude, what is that? What is that? This was a question that he just said, what is your view on integralism? And I didn't have context for that. And I think we can all agree that that's one of the most uncomfortable situations you can face as a public speaker, to be asked a question and not to have Google really handy to see what it is that you're being asked about. So what did I do? I told him that I would look it up right after I got off stage, and I did. I read some scholarly texts. Apparently this is quite the debate, especially on very Orthodox Catholic college campuses. And we talked after, we talked sort of backstage after, because integralism is this idea that our Catholic doctrine specifically, although this applies to all denominations of Christianity, those that hold a biblical worldview, that we should infuse our laws in our country with Catholic doctrine, because as Christians, we believe in objective truth. We believe in first principles, that some things are ordained by God and aren't derived from other premises. And this is obviously controversial among very nerdy Catholic students, as you can imagine. And my position on this is as follows. I think we already do that to a certain extent. I don't actually think that you can escape doing that if you are a nation that identifies right and wrong in your law. And what do we do? Think about not just all the statutory law that we have, but think about the law of our land. Think about the Constitution of the United States. What do we have protected in our Bill of Rights? We have these fundamental human rights that our founders identified as these first principles. They identified as things that were given to you by God. They were not loaned to you on privilege from the government, and that a government is actually instituted for the purpose of protecting those God-given rights and cannot legally, they have no authority to violate that right. That's the entire premise of our country, is natural rights. So what are natural rights? Natural rights are not just something that was stirred up by nature. It's in fact, homicide is the example that comes to mind here, where we say, okay, well, where does the idea of outlawing murder come from? And I asked a student this question one time, and they said, well, it's just common sense. And I laughed and said, no, it's not. It's not common sense. Look at the history of our world. Look at how many murders are committed every single day. It's actually somewhat antithetical to the aggression or anger that we feel in some cases, not to harm someone else. We have reined in that aggressive part of our human nature by acknowledging that every person is made in the image of God, acknowledging that first principle, acknowledging that natural right, acknowledging that government exists to protect that natural right. If that isn't infusing our Catholic doctrine to a certain extent, these absolute truths into our statutes, then I don't know what is. Is that a better answer for you?
Yes, thank you.
So in a similar spirit to the sort of integralism question, actually, the question that I had was about, you know, this inevitable trade-off, I think, that occurs between, you know, instantiating virtue and instantiating liberty.
Yeah.
Even when even in the context of, you know, trying to abolish DEI, right? There's something that made me chuckle a little bit when you talked about, I hope I don't ruffle feathers here.
No, please do. That's the most fun part.
About, for instance, like, you know, compulsory free speech training, right? Because it seems to me that inevitably in a lot of our doctrines and a lot of our policies that we try to instantiate in order to, you know, create liberty, there's always going to be a trade-off, just as there's always a trade-off between liberty and, you know, the promotion of equity. So as a Christian woman, this is something I've been struggling with a lot, especially when it comes to, you know, matters of practically instantiating, you know, these various values. I tend to incline towards the idea that, you know, to be coercive in policy and, you know, trying to shut down DEI things would be actually, again, antithetical to the classical liberal tradition and also to, you know, very Christian anti-coercive values. So with that in mind, you have, you know, I'm a Protestant. Maybe that's part of the
divide
too.
No, this is a great question.
But how do you balance that, especially when it comes to, you know, practically if we're going to shut down DEI? Because it seems to me the underlying question is about changing minds such that they can freely be anti these things rather than top down trying to shut down these programs.
So what you're articulating now is actually the difference in the philosophy between John Locke and Edmund Burke. John Locke had a very libertarian idea of liberty, where if you are not directly violating someone else's right, then you should be free to do whatever it is that you want to do. You should be free to make bad decisions, just as you're free to make good decisions. Edmund Burke proposes this idea of ordered liberty, which is best articulated, actually, by John Adams, who said that our constitutional republic is made for a moral and religious people and no other, that there is a trade-off between liberty and virtue, and absolute liberty, which is anarchy, right, is not going to last. Absolute liberty is what happens in a pure democracy. Absolute liberty does not have the longevity that we have had in our nation. What you've also articulated is the battle that is happening on the inside of the Republican Party right now in the conservative movement. Because we have been a Republican Party that has tended toward libertarian ideals in the past 20 or 25 years. And very recently, we have come to the understanding that that is simply not workable. That in utopia, maybe it would be, but it's simply not workable. It's the first time that we've tended towards libertarianism. It's a grand experiment, and it simply hasn't worked. Because what happened is about 15, 20 years ago, the left proposed this idea of tolerance. They were just calling it tolerance at the time. They hadn't labeled it inclusion yet. And they told us at the state level that we should remove all of our morals, all of our ethics from state law, that there should be a completely neutral playing ground so that every person could define what was right and wrong and live their lives accordingly. And so Republicans and conservatives, fortunately it was not our generation, were very naive, and they said, okay, that sounds great to me. That's what we believe as human beings, especially Christians. We believe in free will. Let's do that at the governmental level. Well, what happened practically? What happened was not a libertarian utopia that allowed people to live as they wanted, whether or not someone else agreed to them with them. What happened is the left snuck in their twisted version of morality at the state level and tried to force us to live by that amorality. And so right there is the case study for what happens in a constitutional republic like ours when you try to implement John Lockean libertarian idea of absolute liberty with an Edmund Burke ordered liberty philosophy. And there's a big difference between a college and university that has an average of 40 plus DEI personnel when those DEI personnel are being funded by us, the taxpayer. It's one thing if it was just a cultural battle where the radical left was out protesting, you know, their viewpoints, and of course they enjoy a right to free speech. We're not going to shut them down. It's a very, very different thing when they are taking money out of our paychecks and using that to actively label our children as racist, as sexist, and actively discriminating against some of us based on the color of our skin or our sex and gender. And so there is a trade-off, to circle back to the beginning of this, there is a trade-off between absolute liberty and virtue, and we are in the midst of this grand experiment in our country where we are trying to find that balance, and it is a fundamentally good thing to see the Republican Party move away from the Lockean idea of libertarianism. Thank you for your question.
Hello, thank you for coming. My name is Gabrielle, and I'm with the Catholic University of America chapter. My question for you has to do with foreign policy. Considering the rise of isolationism in the name of restraint or realism, as they phrase it now, on both the left and the right, how do you recommend we students push forth the notion and the understanding that in the Russian invasion of Ukraine is actually horrible for Americans here on American soil, whether it comes from hyperinflation in addition to what we already have, the national security threats, and the global food crisis that we're about to face. How do you recommend that we push past that and push for a more engaged, yet not overly engaged foreign policy?
So are you asking for an argument in favor of U.S. involvement helping Ukraine or for U.S. not to be involved with Ukraine?
What's your position on that?
Well, my position on that is that it is a fundamentally bad thing for Russia to invade Ukraine. That's pretty obvious, no matter what you think America's role is. I do think there's an argument to be made that the U.S. has a strategic interest in Ukraine remaining a sovereign nation. There's certainly an argument for that. There's an argument from simply a containment standpoint that socialists, as Vladimir Putin is, I mean, a former member of the KGB who still acts like one, socialists are imperialists. He wants to spread his poisonous ideology around the globe, and he's made that very clear. This isn't the first time, and it probably won't be the last time. There is a strategic interest from a perspective of containment to be involved. There's also a strategic interest because of U.S. military bases and U.S. presence in that area. It's a very tenuous area, and using Reagan's philosophy of peace through strength, Americans being in that area ready to respond is an incredible deterrent effect. So is there an argument to be made that the U.S. has some strategic interest in fighting that fight? Yes. Does the U.S. have an interest in waging war against Russia on behalf of Ukraine? No, we don't. We don't have an interest in fighting with another nuclear nation over what's essentially a border dispute when, even if Ukraine's in the right, which they are, and Russia's in the wrong, which they are, when we can't even secure our own border. We don't have an interest in sending tens and hundreds of billions of dollars to a corrupt nation with a corrupt president who poses for Vogue to try to win over Hollywood celebrity support instead of realizing that if what he asked had come to fruition, if the US had actively enforced a no-fly zone against the Russians, that would have made it a war, not Russia against Ukraine, but Russia against the United States. That would have been detrimental to the world. So should we be very skeptical of what Zelensky is asking from the United States? Yes. Should we be very skeptical of our Congress giving almost an unlimited amount of money to this nation in their fight? Yes. Should we completely abandon them and pretend that what happens on the other side of the world doesn't impact us at all? No. As many foreign policy arguments and strategies are, there's a nuanced third position that the Republican Party, it might not show up as well on Twitter, you might not be able to pack it into 240 characters, but it would better serve our nation and the world.
This will be our final question of the evening.
Testing. Hello, I'm Joseph Cagle. I'm going to University of North Florida. So you challenged us to abolish diversity, equity, and inclusion institutions within colleges. We can try to convince our fellow students of our views, but at the end of the day, it's going to take school administrators to remove these leftist institutions. So what are some practical and effective methods we can use when interacting with these school administrators after we've done the work to win hearts and minds?
Well, it's actually even bigger than that. You don't just have to convince your school administrators, you have to convince federal legislators to untie federally backed student loan monies from DEI offices on college campuses. Because right now, even a Christian university, which shall not be named, has a DEI office on their campus because they want to accept federally backed student loan money. So you have to convince your legislators at the state and at the federal level to untie that money from college campuses, because it's wrong to use taxpayer money for racism, discrimination, and religious persecution. So it's not just a matter of convincing your administrators. But when you say convincing your administrators, you need to force your administrators. This is not a conversation that you have where you say, pretty please, would you mind undoing the DEI office? We don't like this and we think it's harmful to people. No, no. You expose the abuse that they are inflicting on people, and you strongly and firmly and politely and respectfully demand that this is abolished. And if it's not abolished, then you take it to the media and you expose to the American taxpayer exactly how their money is being abused to target young people on college campuses. So it's not a matter of simply convincing an administrator. It's a matter of putting pressure on that administrator from every political avenue that you possibly can, which is dissent, it is the press, it is protests, it's individual reporting, it's state legislatures, it's donors to the school, who, by the way, are oftentimes more conservative than the administrations at the school, and it's by collecting a body of students at your school to make their voices heard and say, we will not tolerate this.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. It is my honor and my privilege and my pleasure to be with you tonight. And please, please don't forget to invite me to come to your college campus this fall. You can go to yaf.org/Liz and invite me. We certainly have a lot of topics to talk about, and it's always a good time. So Governor Walker, thank you for having me. Young America's Foundation, thank you for everything you do. Everyone watching online, thank you. And to all of you students, I will see you next year. Let's go fight the good fight.